You have reached the Geek Elite. Good luck.
So yeah, which thank you, Mitch, for choosing the clip in which I just randomly laugh because my mom gives me a glass of water in the middle of my speech.
The future comes, and now my watch begins. It shall not end until my death. I shall miss no game, withhold no news, report all rumors. I shall wear no jerseys and plead allegiance to no side. I shall live and die on my webpage. I am the word in the darkness. I am the watcher of the TV. I am the megaphone that informs the realms of geek. I pledge my hands and name to the Geeks Watch for the geeks and all the geeks to come.
Welcome back for another shift on the Geeks Watch. This week we are talking about WandaVision, episode 8. Previously
Wait,
on.
What is it?
What's the name of the
previously
episode?
On.
Previously no, on. What episode is this?
Is it episode 8?
Is it 7?
No, yeah. It should be episode 8.
What did I say before?
No, yeah, it's episode 8, but what does that make this episode?
Oh, that's right.
Oh.
As John taught me, it is the penultimate episode.
Oh.
Episode.
Penultimate.
I didn't realize it was the second to last. I didn't know that.
It's the second to last.
We only have one more?
Yeah, we only
have one. Believe it, honestly. I don't
lies.
Believe it.
Yeah. There's no way. There is no way.
There's Elizabeth literally got at the end of this episode, and she's just like, there's no way they're only going to get everything cleared up in one episode. It's not going to happen.
I don't know.
It is not physically possible to wrap up that many storylines in any form in half an hour. It's just not possible.
Oh, no, but it's supposed to be an hour.
It's supposed to be an hour, yeah.
This is just a setup, and it's going to get resolved in like 3 other movies.
I'm going to be so pissed.
I mean, yeah, I don't want that.
I do not find that funny.
Seeing as how they say there's no plans for a season 2 of WandaVision, yeah.
Pissed.
Already?
But before we get to that, as always, we will get into our week's watch, and that will be our episode. So let's get right into it. Elizabeth, what did you watch this week?
I didn't pull any of this up.
I have it right here.
Okay, well, I'm gonna put on my glasses so I can see it, because that's kind of far away.
So the unfortunate thing about having to live with me is that I do a lot of different podcasts, just like everybody else on this podcast.
So I have to watch all the things. Correction, I don't have to watch all the things, but it's what's playing in the living room, and I don't know how to operate the TV that's up here. So, nor do I really know how to operate the TV. I'm a little bit better at the TV in our bedroom, but I can't operate this one. So... recently,
that's what you guys get for having the Chinese remote. You know, it's just in Chinese. It's crazy. I don't know why you guys do that.
I mean, if she doesn't want to learn the Q form, then it's not my fault.
I don't even know what Q form is. I can't figure this out. Anyway, so recently Mitch had on for Journey into Mystery, the 1979 Captain America.
Oh, God.
And yeah, oh, yeah,
I'm
that
sorry.
Was, that was, yes, thank you. Thank you. So everybody who wants to hear a more in-depth discussion about this, please go listen to the Journey into Mystery podcast from a week or two ago.
Just this past week.
Just this past
the
week.
Most recent episode of Journey into Mystery was the 1979 Captain America made for TV movie pilot.
Oh my God. It was painful. It was so painful. And like, I had previously watched whatever the Hulk one was that you guys were watching. I don't even know. And like, that was bad in terms of like special effects bad, but like the storyline was relatively good. The acting was pretty darn decent. The 1979 Captain America, one, I did have to stop him mid-movie and just confirm that this wasn't some alternate origins, like there wasn't this origin story in like the comic books, because I'm like, I have never come across this as like Captain America being the son of Captain America. Like I was like, what is this and what is going on? Because I have no idea. And then on top of that, like the acting was bad. Like the acting was, and like I don't normally notice, but like for me to notice, you have to know it was really bad, because like I just, that's not what I care about. I care about the storyline. I care about, you know, the plot holes or the cliffhangers, but yet the acting was so bad. It was so painful. But so that's what I watched this week, because...
Because I was watching it this week.
Mitch was watching it.
So yes, you have. If you want to go and listen to the latest episode of Journey into Mystery, you can hear Ian and myself and Case Aiken from the Certain POV Network rant and rave about the 1979 made-for-TV movie, Captain America, which was supposed to be a pilot for a TV series, but... obviously did not do well enough. They had enough for their next movie, which came out later that year in 1979, which we couldn't find anywhere on online, so we can't watch it and talk about it.
Which is the movie?
It's called Captain America 2, Death Too Soon. And not Death 2, like the number 2 soon, but Death T-O soon, like proper English, but like totally missed out on an opportunity, we feel.
Except,
yeah, I agree.
Is it literally just T-O, not T-O-O?
No, it's T-O-O.
Okay, I was going to say, okay. If it's just say T-O,
that's grammatically incorrect.
Yeah. Proper grammar. It's literally just that. it is only later.
Well, no, it's the bad guy's name is Soon, so it's death to him.
okay. T-S-U-N.
but yes, so that is, and that stars... a gentleman by the name of Reb Brown as Steve Rogers, Captain America. And pre-Super Soldier Serum, he is a very big, beefy dude. Like, straight up muscles everywhere. They constantly have him wearing very tight shirts and being a surfer dude. Because when you think Captain America, you think surfer dude.
So I just looked up something about Death Too Soon right now. Christopher Lee was in that movie.
Yep.
And he played a character named Miguel. I don't think Christopher Lee looks like a Miguel.
I mean...
not in any world.
In 1979 Hollywood? Sure.
That's fair. Yeah.
All ethnic backgrounds were played by white dudes. So.
That's true.
But yeah, so I have no idea where you found that, because it literally just... that appeared on the TV.
That is available for rent on YouTube or Google Play or I assume iTunes. I got it on Google Play because I had a credit, so it was free to us.
Very exciting. Not worth the Google credit.
That's why I take a picture of all those receipts that we use we get throughout the end of the week. Gives us Google Play money.
So many receipt pictures. Yeah.
Which I feel fairly confident I can find this movie for you guys to have to endure this. I'll take this on as a mission. So you guys have to watch Two Death Too Soon, Captain America.
You know what?
I feel like then you would have to be the guest star on it, though.
Exactly.
No. I make the thumbnails. I can just stop making the thumbnails.
If you can find that for us, then I will definitely watch it, and I'm sure Ian will as well.
Could you try and pick a week where I have to like be out of the house all week?
I'll do my best.
Can you hold off till then?
Yeah, no, I'll look forward to having this one for Journey into Mystery, like the bonus content, extra credits.
That's right. It will be a part of our Patreon. okay, there you go. Captain America, 1979. John, I mean, he knows all about those made-for-TV Marvel movies. We did that whole stint on the Geeks Watch, this show, back in the day when it was just John and myself.
Yeah, we didn't cover the Captain America, though, surprisingly.
We did not. We did do Punisher, though.
Yes,
Dolph Lundgren Punisher. So I'm looking forward to that one again. Steven, what did you watch this week?
So I watched a lot of things, but not many of them were new things, I don't think. So I guess the one that I'm going to talk about is the Young Rock TV show.
Oh, I've been meaning to catch that. Is it any good?
I like it.
Good.
I think it's one of the best versions of the whole, like, what was the one? The Chris Young Rock Sheldon? One? Everybody Hates Chris?
Oh, yeah.
Young Everybody Sheldon?
Chris,
any
yeah.
of those
Oh, yeah. Everybody Hates Chris. Yeah, yeah.
I think it's better than that. And I'm not even a massive wrestling fan or anything, but I still feel a certain amount of nostalgia for the local wrestling that they show in there just by the sheer act of having gone to Friends Who Wrestles local shows. So even if it's just that, I think it's a great time. There's parts in there where do you guys know the main thrust of what the show is supposed to be doing? Besides showing The Rock when he's younger?
Is it...
I didn't even know about the show until it came on. So.
There's supposed to be three different versions of him, so I assume it's all about him and his family.
Yeah. So the thing for it is that in the beginning of the episode, it's 2032, The Rock is running for president. And he's doing this interview series with the actor who plays Agent Wu.
Randall Park.
Yeah, with Randall Park. And he's doing an interview series where Randall Park all the time, consistently, he'll do something which is like this like very awkward behavior. And he'll be like, yeah, I did a great job with that one, right? Did I mention I was an actor? That's why I did that so great right now. Because he used to be an actor. And now he's just doing interviews, I guess. But
so he's playing himself.
Yeah, and he's not aged up in any way.
That's Asian's
way. Neither... I mean, that's fair. But yeah, so in the show, he's supposed to be kind of doing this interview series to kind of lightly air his dirty laundry so that it's already out there. He's taken the Eminem and 8 Mile approach. What can they say about me if I say it first?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So that's the whole conceit of the show. And then we just get to see a person who's playing a younger Andre the Giant. And we see a young Iron Sheik, which they cast fantastically. That was great. It's pretty good. It's a normal sitcom that's in no way, shape, or form blazing any new trail, but it's a fun time. We've been watching them. I believe we're watching them on Hulu as they come out each week. And it's just a nice little thing to have there.
You're watching on Hulu, but it is a NBC show.
Yeah. So. Yeah. You can watch it on normal television and everything, but yeah. Also, we finally found a place to stream The Nanny, so that's cool. There are a few seasons of The Nanny on Pluto TV. That's nice.
Oh, so you checked out Pluto TV?
Yeah, I think we're going to use Pluto a lot. There's a whole sci-fi channel that's just playing random sci-fi things.
There's
and
a
I really like
for
it.
Just Mystery Science Theater 3000.
Yeah, the whole thing they seem to do is to just have channels for individual shows and just air them through the day, which is what I think Netflix should have been doing. Pluto is beating Netflix by being free and just having these random channels. So... I like Pluto TV a lot.
You are going to get everybody obsessed with this.
I am. I got obsessed
thing.
With it. I found it. I mean, I've heard people have been talking about it forever, and I just found it like when we were at a friend's house, and I was like, this is extremely interesting. Like,
it's great.
So many channels and just random stuff.
And it's free.
And it's free.
It's weird. They have, I don't know if they have a deal or something with who gets to be the default channel when you start Pluto, but currently it's just episodes. It's the channel, quote unquote. That's all just Deal or No Deal.
Oh my God.
And so you turn it on and like whatever you're watching, if you choose to watch one of the on-demand things and not a channel, it just reverts to Howie Mandel talking about like what you're going to get for this case or not. Yes. It's interesting.
That's funny. So Young Rock. Yeah, that's funny because I know it had to have been last year when he was talking about running for president. Mm-hmm. So it was all just viral marketing for the show eventually.
I honestly think it's a two-sided attack on that one. That was viral marketing for the show, which still feels like it's like a distinct possibility that The Rock actually runs for president later. I don't think that there's anything that would stop this from happening. I mean, the man had inside knowledge about bin Laden being killed before plenty of people in the government knew that bin Laden had been killed. So,
I mean,
there's something there.
Because he had family that was on the team.
I'm just saying.
Okay. There you go. That The Rock is on NBC. You can find it on Peacock or Hulu if you don't watch regular television.
Jessica, or Hulu if you're nasty.
Jessica, what did you watch this week?
So I've been continuing my watching old animated Marvel shows on Disney Plus before going to sleep. So I've gone through now the Spider-Man show that came out around the same time that Spider-Man and Friends came out. So, but it's just Spider-Man. But it used, I think, I can't remember what year, 1970, 1980 something.
With the meme.
Yes, the one with the meme. Yes, that one. And Spider-Man, I honestly, I think I slept.
Amazing Friends?
No, it's not Amazing Friends because I already did the Amazing Friends one. And apparently at the same time as Amazing Friends, there was another just Spider-Man show. And which I learned about when I was reading about the Amazing Friends. And it is the one where the meme comes from. But honestly, I think I slept through most of it because it just wasn't holding my attention as much as Amazing Friends was. Not that it was necessarily bad, but it was oddly a lot like Amazing. In fact, it used the same, like, I don't know how, like, cut scene graphics. Like, you know, when animated shows are like cutting the scene, so they show a little graphic in between them. Had the same thing. Yeah, like that. Had the same as Amazing Friends. And it was clear that it came out at the same time. The animation was fairly the same as well. But it had a different voice for Peter Parker. And it was just interesting. I was like, okay, cool. And now I am on X-Men.
Ooh.
From the 90s.
So,
the one with the.
Okay.
The best one. That one. Yeah.
Actually, no, I mean, X-Men Evolution was also good, to be fair.
Yeah, that's one I think I'm hoping to get to.
But prior to that, did you get to watch X-Men Pride of the X-Men?
No, I don't know if that one was on there. I'm trying to kind of watch them chronologically, but with the way it's not like Disney Plus has them chronological. And at the time that I was selecting it, it was like, you know, 10 o'clock at night, and I should have been asleep when I was selecting my next one. So I kind of like, yeah, this one's old.
That Pride of the X-Men one, wasn't that like part of like the Marvel action packed hour or something like that? Or
yeah. And it was a pilot to like make a full series that didn't get picked up. And then later it became that Fox X-Men.
Yeah. I don't know if they, have that. If they would have that on Disney or not. I mean, it's all owned by them, but I just don't know if it's on Disney Plus or not.
I have no idea.
That would be a shame.
They have a good amount, but I don't know. I don't know if I saw that one or not. There was quite a few X-Men ones, but I think it was the more later on ones that I actually recognized. So
the biggest difference, besides having a couple of characters like Dazzler instead of
Jubilee,
like Rogue and Jubilee, yeah. Is that Wolverine has a really heavy Australian accent.
Yeah, he does.
That's why I always thought he was Australian, because of that one show.
Because that one, yeah, that's what started it. And then they cast an actual Australian, and, you know, then just kind of solidified it.
Yeah, but he's Canadian.
He is Canadian, huh?
They all have the queen on their money. It's all the same.
Well, he was from the Canadian district of Australia.
In the Canadian quarter.
Yeah.
Jess, I'm wondering, as a person who's watching this show, and you are like, you probably watched this a bit when you were younger and everything, but I think
not this specific show. I don't think I've ever seen the specific show. I saw the one where they were like teenagers, I think.
X-Evolution.
I don't think I ever saw this one because I don't recognize it at all.
Oh, man.
Other than I recognize like images of it, but like actually watching it, I don't recognize the voices. I don't recognize the animation. I'm like, I don't know this. Man. Now I understand why people like Rogue and Gambit so much, because I never understood why people liked Rogue and Gambit, and now watching this, like, oh, I get it now.
Yeah. But like Gambit's, have you gotten to Gambit's best line in the entire series yet?
I don't know what is his best line.
You told Gambit it wouldn't hurt. When she goes and kisses him.
No, I haven't gotten to that part yet. But the other thing, I don't know if it's Disney Plus. I don't know if they aired it differently than how they actually filmed the episodes. But the episodes are out of chronological order.
No, it sounds like Fox in the 90s.
Episode 1, 2, 3. Okay, good, because it's driving me nuts because it keeps on jumping the timeline, and I'm like literally in the worst spots. Like there was a scene in which they're going back to the mansion after a mission, and then the mansion just crumbles. and then literally the next episode is them already building it up and talking to the professor, who was missing at the time. So I'm like, so they just randomly found the professor in between these episodes and didn't write it? I was so confused. And then it jumped back. And I was like, what the hell happened? Like, I felt like I was going insane watching this.
No, Fox had a really bad track record with that kind of thing in the 90s. Like, Mitch and John, like, correct me if I'm wrong here, but they did that to a bunch of shows. Like,
Firefly.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, they often did that, but with the cartoon, they would do it even more because it's like, it's just kids watching it. They don't care.
It's just a cartoon. Yeah. No, I care now, but I might not have noticed it when I was a kid because I mean, they do give you the previously on X-Men thing. And that's how I caught it, was like they were doing previously on X-Men, and I was like, that was like 5 episodes ago. Why are you showing me this again? Like, what's happening? But I know, I like Rogue. I like Jubilee was someone I didn't know a lot about either, and I think she's a fun character. I don't know if I love Wolverine, but I think it's only because I love Hugh Jackman's Wolverine, and this is not Hugh Jackman's Wolverine. It's interesting. I think what I do like about it is these shows are really showing me a lot about those more complex comic book stories. So I think the current one that I am watching is actually Days of Future Past, which is a movie I watched but didn't quite I understood it, but I was like, whatever about it. But now watching this show within it, I'm like, oh, I see why people were mad about the liberties they took with this. Like, okay, I get it. But
did you by any chance watch the Apocalypse one? The movie?
That's the one where they started the Apocalypse line and then it went back. Now it's doing Days of Future Past. So I assume after Days of Future Past, I'll get back to Apocalypse. So I'm literally like learning all the comic book things at once, and I'm like trying to piss it, like, how are these things happening at the same time? Like, this just sucks. Sentinels, and then what is his name, Galacticus or whatever.
Galactus.
Is it Galacticus it is? Yeah,
I like Galacticus better. I think that sounds better.
Galacticus.
I don't think Galactus shows up in the X-Men. He usually shows up in the Fantastic Four
or Silver Surfer.
Well, who is it that does? Oh, then it's just Apocalypse. What's his name that does Apocalypse?
Oh, Sinister?
Leads the Four Horsemen?
Oh.
I had no idea. I thought it was...
The Four Horsemen.
Yeah.
That's Apocalypse.
Yeah.
Okay, then it's just Apocalypse. I don't know why I'm calling it... I don't know. It's giving me... Like I'm doing the Sentinels, Days of Future Past, and then the Four Horsemen at the same time because it keeps jumping between those two. And I'm like, man, the X-Men's got to be strapped. They're dealing with two world-ending events at the same time.
That's why they're so good.
Yeah, and that's how tired I am watching it, because it took me like 8 episodes to realize it was jumping around, and that's why I was so confused. I'm like, now I get it. I'm supposed to be confused.
It really makes you long for the glory days of them just having to deal with the weird dinosaur birdman who's stealing powers from people. You know?
I mean, Sauron's a good character.
Yeah, Sauron was good. Like, they didn't have any world-ending stuff. They were just on that island, and Sauron's changing back and forth.
They do go to the Savage Land in X-Men, don't they?
They do. Mm-hmm. Have you ever seen, like, people pass it around online a lot? But there is a issue, and there's a panel in this issue of Spider-Man, where Spider-Man has to fight Sauron, like the pterodactyl dude that steals life force from people. Uh-huh. And in the panel, like the dude used to be a man. He used to be a scientist, and he figured out a way to just steal people's life force and rewrite it, and so that they can change into he steals their life force, but he also changes them into dinosaurs. And Spider-Man's like freaking out about this, because he's like, you know how to rewrite someone's DNA on the fly into dinosaurs, and you're using it to do this? And he goes, you could be curing cancer. He's like, I don't want to cure cancer. I want to turn people into dinosaurs. It's, I don't know. I just thought it was hilarious.
I want to cure cancer.
I like that, though. God. But like, they really, Spider-Man's the one they seem to have the most fun with, breaking like real world things down. Like, was it Civil War way back when they're like, yeah, I can get Spider-Man to join the team. And all Tony Stark does is go to Peter Parker and say, we have money. And yeah. Peter Parker's just crying on his shoulder, like, yep. I'll join you.
That's exactly what happens.
Yeah.
It's good. But that's what I was going to say about the X-Men, the 90s X-Men show and the 90s Spider-Man show. Like, both did really good job of sticking to comic storylines, like how the story played out in the comic books, as opposed to like the later Spider-Man shows and the later X-Men series. Like, they usually always change things up. You got the story gist, but they changed it up on how it came out in the comic books. So I hope you're enjoying it.
I actually am. For as confused as I am, I'm actually quite enjoying the characters. I think the one thing that's actually annoying me is the fact that the female heroes like to faint a lot.
But yeah, especially Jean Grey, like the most powerful X-Men.
And her outfit confused the crap out of me. Like, it took me forever to realize that she's not like half naked. Like, she just has like cream. Because it literally just looks like her outfit is like a T-shaped thing. And I'm like, what? Who designed this? Like, and then I looked up at it and I was like, oh, I get it. Because what didn't make sense was that the other outfits for the other females, although form-fitting, aren't necessarily like overly showy. Like, it's Rogue still has all a covered
full jacket.
Yeah, and then Jubilee looks like a normal teenager, and Storm is like a cool, awesome white cape thing. Yep. But I was like, why is Jean half naked? Like, this makes zero sense. And it took me, oh no, it's just cream colored to match her skin. Okay,
cream colored.
I was still like,
suit.
I don't like it. Yeah, it's
this
weird.
Was that time frame. This was that point where the X-Men comics had an overabundance of pouches and straps.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So they're just
and
everywhere.
Head frame mask things, which are the best thing in all of comics.
Just, the anti-mask. Like,
Shatterstar got one in the Deadpool movie. They actually kept that in there, and that's the best thing they've ever done.
And then I feel like my other complaint is I've never in the movies liked Jean and Scott's relationship. I definitely hate it now watching it in this. I'm like, oh my god, just get with Wolverine already. Like, I can't stand Jean and Scott. I can't.
So you know on Jean's outfit, that those things that she has around her shoulders?
Uh-huh. That's awesome, like 80 shoulder pads.
Yeah, but they kind of like, it's like fins that go into the armpit kind of and then come back around. So do you all remember like Mad Magazine?
I know it existed. Yes, I think I've read one once.
As a child, I had a subscription to Mad Magazine. That's right, subscriptions.
That's awesome.
They used to do parodies of TV shows, and X-Men was one of the ones they did. In their parody of Jean Grey, instead of like those fin things, she had spare tires like around her arms. I always remember that. So whenever I see that specific costume on Jean, I think about the spare tires around her shoulders.
Interesting. I think I'm thinking of the wrong thing, because I'm thinking of like the long pointy ones that she had.
Yeah.
Well, they kind of move. So occasionally they're long and pointy, and occasionally they look like she's wearing tires around her. Like, I think it depends on who's animating it at the time or if they're just being lazy or not.
Because
there is a lot of animation mistakes in these old. Mm-hmm. Like, this stuff would not fly nowadays with how. Well, it's, I mean, it does help. Computer technology probably helps that out. Like, this is all hand drawn.
You have like faster returns and reviews.
Yeah. Sure. So like, I'm not going to be like, they suck. Like, no, they're great for their time. But like,
they look like pointy shoulder pads that kind of like have a little bit of a roundness to them.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's definitely. And she has ripped thigh pads for some reason.
Yeah, ripped like it's
thigh pads.
Ripped thigh pads. Oh, yeah, like on her outer. Yeah, she's got like these large, just like, I don't know, like extra storage area, I guess. But it looks like it's just like to cushion a landing.
I don't know. I don't, because it's not like she does a lot of fighting. She literally like mainly stands back and beams at her forehead and then faints, and Scott's Jane, and she's like, I'm fine. Like, that's that's it.
Jessica's not judging at all.
Well, actually, I'm curious, how do you feel about Professor Xavier's voice in this one? I don't want to linger on this one too much, but oh boy, there's a lot to talk about in this cartoon.
It's more the eyebrows.
I don't love it. Yeah, the eyebrows drive me nuts, and I don't know, it's not my favorite.
He sounds like just a Robot Chicken character, like, to me, my X-Men. It's really bad.
No, I'm not going to be able to watch Skeletor.
Yeah, that's what it sounds like. It's really bad.
I think that's how he sounds in the arcade game.
I don't think it's that bad.
I don't know. His voice bugs me. Logan's voice bugs me. Wolverine's voice bugs me.
You don't
Everybody
like that.
Else is
lower
okay.
Register, gruff.
It yeah. It just it's like, and I'm like, oh god, shut up, Wolverine. Just fight something. Like just stop trying just to talk. Stop talking. Yes.
Well, okay, there you go. X-Men from the 90s is on Disney Plus. Yes. You can go and remember the nostalgia with Jessica if you want to join in.
Mm-hmm.
Or watch it for the first time.
Or
yeah, like actually more like me, because I really don't remember ever watching it.
John, what did you watch this week?
Hey, before I begin, you have no excuse. They have Captain America and Captain America 2, Death Too Soon, for $5.99. It's a 2-pack on Amazon Prime.
Really?
That's what I was looking at. Yeah.
It wasn't there when I went to go look at it was not
it's,
there.
Well, it's see, there right now.
It's a 2-pack, so it might not have done just through the search for just the individual.
No.
It has 4 out of 5 stars. This thing is highly reviewed.
That's not what I got. What I found was 3.8 out of 10.
Out of 10? Are you sure it's like 4 out of 10 there, John?
No, this one. Well, maybe because it's the 2-pack, but this, yeah, it's got some glowing reviews, and they're not recent. They're from like a few years ago, 2012, 2015, 2011, and well, I mean, all of them are saying right away that this is like super nostalgia. They saw it when they were kids, but still, it's there.
All right, well, I will get a hold of Ian.
Why do you all hate me?
No, I don't hate you. This one, I'm saying I want to facilitate this happening solely so Ian has to watch this.
Yeah, no, it's Ian that they're picking on, really. Poor
Except
Ian.
I'm collateral damage.
I wouldn't put it past him. He doesn't just flat out not watch it. He didn't watch Spider-Man.
That's fair. That's Call fair. Them out. Call them out.
Ian did
but
not
for completion purposes.
All right, John, what did you watch this week?
I watched a movie I wanted to watch when it first came out in 2019. Wow, that feels so long ago now. A little horror movie called Brightburn. With involvement from,
James Gunn.
Is that the kid that was like evil Superman?
Yes.
Yep.
Basically,
okay, cool.
Yes.
It's a blood splashy Superman movie.
It's don't watch this movie if you want to feel good about life.
And I'm not watching it.
This thing is very dark, very violent, and very cynical. Now, some people say this could be a dark superhero movie or like a twisted take on Superman. No, this is straight up a horror movie. It just happens to be that the horror comes from a kid with, like, essentially superpowers. This little Makes kid sense. Essentially has the same origin story as Superman, or as I would like to point out, Goku from Dragon Ball.
Goku is just Superman. They knew.
Basically.
Toriyama knew what he was doing.
Yeah.
But with a more specific slant in that this kid was specifically sent to Earth, apparently, to conquer it.
That makes sense.
So, yeah, like, the movie begins, like, most of these superhero origin stories begin. This kid seems to be a good kid all around until the spaceship he landed on Earth with, like, flicks on and starts sort of, like, reprogramming him. And he, you know, like, he didn't seem to have any real superpowers prior or wasn't aware that he had them until that happens. And then all of a sudden, he's, like, invulnerable. He's super strong. He figures out he can fly, he can, you know, shoot laser beams out of his eyes. He's Superman, basically. And he even comes up with his own little logo, which is a combination of the two B's from his name, or could also be considered, you know, to be representative of the name Brightburn, which is the small Midwestern town that this is supposed to take place in. It'll stand in for Smallville. It stars Elizabeth Banks and David Denham, who you may remember more as Roy from The Office.
Roy.
Oh.
Okay.
Wait, so they were both in Power Rangers together also.
Was he?
Oh.
Who was he in Power Rangers?
Oh, no. I thought, never mind. I was thinking of this backwards. I was thinking of him as the Red Ranger's dad. But the Red Ranger's dad, I believe, is actually... It's neither here nor there. I think he was actually the dad from Free Willy back in the day.
Oh. Oh. Well, I believe you. That sounded convincing to me. I thought that was him, too. So, going back to this one, just a brief summary of this movie. Yeah, it's dark, guys. Like, this is not a feel-good horror movie.
Are there?
Some of them can be campy and fun, you know, but this one is just like, yes, and Frighteners is definitely a feel-good scary movie. I think the thing I was the most surprised about is just how extreme the gore actually is. Like, they don't hold back. Like, they do some pretty gross stuff in this movie, and for that part, I enjoyed it. But like, man, this is you don't feel good after watching this.
When that lady gets that piece of glass in her eye, that freaked me the hell out. Yeah.
So I did want to mention that portion or that plot point specifically because, yes, at one point, the little kid causes glass to break and it shoots into this woman's face. You actually see a shard of glass, like, in the center of her eye. And she's, like fumbling, trying to pull it out.
You don't pull it out.
Oh, wait, no, Elizabeth left the room. She's flipping us off now. She leaves. Wow, she did not like that.
She didn't like that at all. All
right. I will definitely leave that, but let's just say it's crazy. And I mainly just chose this movie because I was kind of flipping through and I was like, all right, I gotta watch something. What do I gotta watch? This was only 90 minutes, so it's a pretty brief movie. It doesn't take very long. It establishes everything you need to know. But man, does this movie make you feel uncomfortable? Because not only does he have superpowers, he's also going through puberty. And with great power comes a great need to explore some of your curiosities.
Now I'm less interested in the movie.
It doesn't go to the nth degree that you would think, but it definitely plants that idea that, like, oh no, like, if this kid wanted to, he could do everything he's thinking of and more, and like, no one could stop him.
I mean, he's essentially, we keep saying he's Superman, but he's also like, he's Homelander. If he's the kid version of Homelander.
It's a lot closer. I was definitely getting some The Boys vibes from this because as we come to find out towards the end, it sounds like he might not be the only one that's like this. They kind of do like a real brief, like, oh, and there's these reports of these other people that are like him. They make a brief mention how one of them is like aquatic and is kind of like a dark, twisted looking Aquaman type character. And they have some of them are like blank that you don't see descriptions of what they look like, but it basically sets it up for like, oh, we have like an evil Justice League thing going on here. And a very cool little cameo by Michael Rooker, which I was like, oh, that must be the James Gunn influence there.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, cynical, dark movie, interesting take on the superhero trope. And I think the only enjoyment I got out of it is kind of twisting it around. And I was like, you know what? A lot of these scary movie characters, like the girl from The Ring, Jason, Freddy Krueger, they're just basically superheroes that haven't been shown the right way yet. There, like, these guys could be using their power for good. Mm-hmm. And I want to see an Avenger-style movie now where you take all these villains, all these horror movie characters, and now they have to use their powers for good and how that would play out.
So you're telling me that Freddy versus Jason back in the early 2000s was just Batman v Superman, like, all over again?
I am absolutely saying this, yes.
Yeah, Freddy versus Jason versus the devil. Like, their team
versus Ash.
Yeah, actually, this is great.
One of my favorite, I want to say it probably originated on the Tumblr post because it's been a few years, but is the idea of a daycare for evil children. And like having like wholesome daycare teachers trying to like raise these kids and make them not be evil, but also dealing with all their kind of sort of evil powers, I thought was like the cutest idea ever. Yeah, because like, I think it's especially prominent for like the girl from The Ring and the fact that she was just a girl that was abused. Like, if somebody had showed that girl love, like, A, would she even have gotten her evil powers? And B, like, you know, like, all it takes is one kind person to help someone through their trauma.
You're very optimistic, but Jessica.
I am also the daycare teacher, so.
What you're saying is you have to watch a lot of little supervillains.
Yes.
But I think
children.
It's just, like,
aren't
funny...
all children just supervillains?
That's what I'm saying. No one ever has a thing where they're like, oh yeah, no, that serial killer, yeah, he just picked it up suddenly in his like 40s. No, it's when they're little kids and then you find out that they are awful. You don't it's not a late in life puberty. Like, you don't, there's no serial killer puberty. They're suddenly super killer or serial killers.
I'm yes say nobody and no. Let
Uncle
actually.
Steven watch their kids.
So no. Okay, so no. In all seriousness, there is a predisposition to being evil. They have found what they thought is actually like a evil neuron, basically. Which there's not enough study behind it, but basically, the length of this neuron in your brain, the longer it is, the more likely you are to have the tendency to have like A, evil thoughts, or B, be super aggressive, or, you know, assault people. But at the same time, your brain has a lot of plasticity, so it can change and adapt. So if you don't ever interact with those aspects of yourself, then that neuron will shrink and it will die out, just like everything else in your brain will shrink and die out. So the people in your life do have an effect on whether or not you are going to be evil or not. Now, if a kid who's predispositioned to that is raised in a traumatic environment, goes through, or even just goes through a lot of trauma, then yes, their brain will be a serial killer brain in a sense. This is very simplifying things. But if that same child in that different universe grows up in a loving family, or even just has a very loving teacher that they connect with or anything, that they might not ever get to the point that they're like killing cats or anything like that. Like, they met, like, I'm serious. It's funny, but I am serious. Like, there really is, like, yes, you are predispositioned to some things from genetics, but it's also, there's also nurturing involved as well on whether or not you'll fully develop them or whether or not they'll die out before you reach adulthood.
So this is going to be,
it's the never ending nature versus nurture debate.
Yes. Which the debate really is, what it's coming to is that it really is a balance. They both have good causes behind them.
I look forward to that exact thing, that scientific thing being brought up in Brightburn 2 when they like go to talk to the other supervillains about the Brightburn initiative.
I'm sorry, I got on like my psychology soapbox.
Also, Roy was the person who played the Red Ranger's dad in this.
Oh,
in Power Rangers.
Look at that.
Yeah.
Wasn't Elizabeth Banks also in some episodes of The Office? I feel like she would have been.
That sounds right.
Yeah.
I feel bad for not knowing.
I don't think so.
Really? I mean, Amy Adams is in some episodes in the beginning, so I just feel like Elizabeth Banks would have been around there too. But maybe I'm just thinking like Elizabeth Banks being in 40-year-old Virgin with Steve Carell, and that's why.
There you go. That's what it is.
Yeah.
So, John, where can people watch Brightburn?
If you want to be bummed out, it's currently streaming on Amazon Prime.
Okay, there you go. My week's watch this week, if you follow me on Twitter, you would have seen that I said something that goes directly into this movie. It's because I watched this movie, and I do not like home invasion movies. Because I watched Knock Knock from 2017? 2015 Eli Roth movie starring Keanu Reeves and a younger Ana de Armas from Knives Out. I don't know why I watched it. I know I don't care for Eli Roth movies in the first place. I think I watched it because of remembering hearing that Ana de Armas is in the movie, and yep, I did not.
She had the shower scene.
She does have the house shower scene. I didn't know about that. I just knew that she was in the movie.
That's all I knew about it.
Their priorities. Different people.
This movie is Keanu Reeves plays this architect who has a very loving family. It's his wife is an artist, and he has two very young kids. She's also Spanish, and they decide to, after Father's Day, after giving Father's Day presents to Dad, they're going to go on vacation. They're going to go to a beach somewhere. They don't really say where. They just say they're going to the beach, and they're going to leave him alone, and he's supposed to meet up with them the next day or days later. It sets it up early in the movie that he is a friendly guy that will help out people if they need help. So around midnight, he gets a knock on his door, and it's pouring rain outside, and there's two young women, and they are soaking wet, and they're like, "We're looking for the Duggery house." And he's like, "There's nobody around here named Duggery." They're like, "Well, my phone is," she's like, "My phone is dead because it got wet from the rain, and we have no way of going anywhere because the cab just dropped us off here." And
good luck.
Bye. Here's $5.
I mean, yes, very much he should be saying, "That's cool. Sorry." But he's like, "Okay, you know, you can use the phone inside to call, you know, call a cab or whoever you need to call. Call your friends that you're supposed to meet." And, you know, they get there, but they don't know the number because all the numbers are in their contacts, which the phone is dead. And he calls a Uber, and he's like, "It's fine. I'll just, you know, get an Uber for you. It's going to take 45 minutes because we live out here in the fucking boonies, and you can take the Uber back." So within the 45 minutes, they, you know, they're talking to him, and they're asking him questions, and he's like, "Oh yeah, when I was young, your age, I used to be a DJ. Here's the catalog of my wife's artwork that she's been putting together. She's great." And then the 45 minutes is up, the Uber's out there, and they went to go grab their clothes from the dryer because they were all soaking wet. And he's like, "Hey, you need to go. Get out." And they start to seduce him. And he's like, "No, no, no." And then eventually he just has sex with them. And the rest of the movie is about how they are going to turn him in for being a pedophile, because they told him that they were 22 and flight attendants. Now they're saying they're 15, and you know, you're gonna go to jail, and they torture him for the rest of the movie. It's basically what the movie is. It's torture porn, because that's what Eli Roth likes to do.
Why this movie? I don't know.
This isn't even really a home invasion.
Well, they come back because he does drop them off. He's like, "You need to get the fuck out." And they leave. And then he drops them off at some other neighborhood that they say that that's where they're staying. And when he goes home the next day, he, after he cleans up the mess that they made, like, they break into the house and they tie him up and torture him.
So. I thought you were going to say that you had watched Funny Games because you used the GIF from Funny Games.
I did use the GIF from Funny Games because that's the movie that made me realize that I hate home invasion movies. So
yeah, Funny Games sucks.
Yeah. So I don't recommend it, but it is available on Hulu.
What was that again?
It was Knock Knock.
Knock Knock. Okay.
Just to make sure you avoid it.
Yeah, that's why I needed that.
I figured. All right, let's get into WandaVision.
1 hour into the podcast.
1 hour later.
Well, we got double vision. The end.
This episode is actually called Previously On because we got to learn about what happened before WandaVision. We got a little bit of a backstory to Agatha Harkness. She belonged to a coven of witches in Salem, Massachusetts in 1869.
With bad decision making skills. Yeah.
What was that?
I said, and her mother tried to kill her.
Her mother tried to kill her because their coven realized that she was using magic a way that they weren't supposed to be using magic. And she turn the attack on them, like, as they were trying to strip her of her powers and life force. She's like, nah, I got this, and just started sucking the life force out of them. Her mother, who also seemed to be very powerful and at least the head of the coven, also was no match for her.
Yep.
So
yeah,
she is a very powerful witch and has been around for a very long time. Using the the younging technology that Marvel likes to do to actors on Catherine Hahn. Like, I don't know. She didn't, it didn't look all that much different, but like, I love Catherine Hahn though. I think she's a great actress. What did you guys think of that effect of trying to make her look like a 20 something?
It was fine.
It was just fine.
Yeah.
Any thoughts on her being from the Salem witch trial? Like when they did that, I was like, oh wait, they're using magic on her. Like when they cuffed her behind the thing, I was like, this is not a regular Salem witch trial.
Yeah, it was like a Salem witch trial. Yeah, Salem witch trial.
Which?
The location was a little too cliche. Which
mountain?
It was just very cliched, which was kind of sad. But I was also like, yeah, this is probably how it is in the comic or something. I don't know. So I was like,
I'm sure she, yes, comic books, if there's a witch character, they're from Salem. Like, it's just the thing they do. Did anybody else think that this beginning scene was going to be an episode all about Agatha?
Yes.
I did not.
Yeah.
Like, that is not what we got, though.
No. I didn't think it would be all that. Yeah.
Yeah.
But,
go ahead, Jessica.
I do like how they showed magic in this episode, though. Because I don't necessarily love magic from nothing. I like magic having something to do, so like spells and stuff. So the fact that she's speaking in Latin while she's doing her crazy hexes and doing the hand movements, I was like, yes, this is the kind of magic I like, as opposed to Wanda just straight up ex machina stuff.
I also really like the Agatha. I like the Agatha's explanation or description of magic, and that, like, how can you do all these crazy things? It takes forever to learn even like the basic stuff, and you're doing it here all willy nilly. I thought that was a pretty cool character beat with her, like, saying, like, oh, like, you can do the good stuff. I need to learn this, whatever it is you're doing.
And this is jumping ahead, but I definitely like how it's not Agatha necessarily, like, running the pictures. It's Agatha being like, what's happening here? And just kind of going along for the ride. I really liked that, too.
Yeah, we got to find out a big piece of it. Like, the thing that we've been debating throughout this whole show is, like, is it just Wanda, or is someone using Wanda, using her powers? And so, like, nope, Wanda created all this shit. Like, she did it all herself with her broken mind.
And she did not steal Vision's body.
And she did not. Yes. So that's a big one.
Yes.
That was the biggest.
And also, I think I did say on podcast that, wouldn't it be that Wanda has Vision inside of her in some way? And that is how it ended up being. So, yay.
I mean, it makes a lot of sense, seeing as how Vision came to life using the Mind Stone. And the Mind Stone is what gave Scarlet Witch her powers, or Wanda her powers. Or, I guess, didn't give her Scarlet powers, Witch, no. But definitely amped up her powers.
Yeah, because that was really interesting to me, was that in the first scene when they're playing out Wanda and Petra's parents dying, that Agatha said, oh, so you stopped the bomb from going off.
With a probability. Yeah.
Which is what her powers were back when.
Exactly. Yes. Yeah, that was her mutant ability, was to be able to manipulate probability and make it look like some type of hex. But yeah, like, I love the way that they're tying in all these things together, so that you have bits and pieces of the comic book and now parts of the MCU all, like, rolled into one. It's pretty great. And then we got to see the reason why all the sitcoms and stuff like that, Dad was trying to sell DVDs to make ends meet. John, you're about to say something?
I was. What was I going to say? Oh, so we were given a sort of semi-official name for fake Pietro, which is Pietro.
Pietro.
I think they could have done more with the word faux in it, because the end of Pietro's name is an O.
Right.
I think they could have flipped the where the faux part is. But whatever.
I did like that Agatha was like, you know, she just basically made up a fake body for this Pietro. Like, she just essentially made a golem, like, character so that she could see through him, see and hear through him. But they didn't really explain why she picked that body and that look. Like, for us as audience members, we know that that is the X-Men universe version of Pietro. But she just said she didn't use her actual brother's body because necromancy is hard and it's in another country.
And there were still holes in the guy. She pointed to the fact that he was full of holes from the bullets and stuff being one of the reasons that she couldn't use that body of, like, original Pietro. Yeah. But this one still had bullet holes when the glimmer of everything was taken off of him. So, and they didn't seem posthumous. Like, they didn't seem posthumous. Like, they weren't except, after he died because there was a blood trail. So,
except because I was thinking about that. If the vision that is in there is entirely created by Wanda, when he left, the vision we saw was the vision that had been lying on the slabs. So I'm wondering if once out of the hex, it reverts to what she actually remembers you looking like. So once that's all gone, she's remembering what Pietro looked like filled with holes.
Yeah.
Because we did also see in that one, for that, by that same token, when the glimmer or whatever is taken off of Vision as well, in that one scene where we see his, like, forehead's, like, caved in.
Right.
That scene, if she just made Vision, that's very odd that we would see that version at all.
Well, but it is all of her powers, and it's all of her powers comes from her mind, and her mind is dealing with a lot of trauma, as Jessica likes to say. Like, she has a lot going on in there. So with the flashbacks, it's just like, I would assume if you were, you know, walking around and you suffered from PTSD, like, you just see things.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
I think that's a good assessment.
Yeah, mm-hmm. That's what I assume is going on too, is like she's having a flashback to her trauma.
That makes sense. I was going to say, did we not get a commercial in this one? But that's because it wasn't the broadcast.
We didn't. We didn't get one in the last one either, though.
We got one in the last one.
Oh, yeah, was Nexus? Yeah. Nexus was in the last one?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Oh. So then there was the one before that we didn't get one.
That was
That was the really creepy one that creeped me out and gave me a nightmare. But it's a previously on. So technically the show hasn't started yet. So there shouldn't be a commercial.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
This does mean, however, that they did get to do the thing that all sitcoms do.
What?
Which is inside of this weird, like, nugget show thing. They still got to have a clip episode. Or it's all flashbacks. They actually got to do that.
That's true. That's fair. We noticed that they kind of retconned what happened with Wanda while she was with Hydra.
Yeah.
Hydra was Baron Strucker was the one that, like, was running the experiments on her and her brother. But now we see that there was some other two stooges and they did it a little bit more clinical as opposed to just, like, touching willy nilly and touching the Wanda to Wanda or the scepter to Wanda. What did you think of the experience? Like, obviously I would say the two scientists didn't see what she saw, but they did see something happen, and when they went to see look at the tape again, or the video, it does the whole editing out that we've seen happen in this show.
So there might be something. Oh, go ahead.
No, see.
Ah, well, if we go back a second to when that happened, and the Mind Stone unseats itself from the scepter and then comes out of that blue casing to show itself in its real, like, form.
Mm-hmm.
She has a vision of what looks like herself or an entity that would be the Scarlet Witch. Just kind of do like a Phoenix type situation with her. Maybe a glimpse into the future, maybe a glimpse into her full potential or something that's, like, unlocking her power. But that Mind Stone seems to have a mind of its own. And this is leading me to have a theory that part of the reason why she doesn't understand a lot of what's happening is because there is a greater power within her. Maybe it's a consciousness, maybe it's the essence of the Mind Stone itself that's having a much larger effect on some of this stuff. And she's just basically going along for the ride.
Yeah, I don't know. I still like the idea of it not just being Wanda hurt real bad, so Wanda reshape reality. Like, I like there being something past that. When this episode seemed to pull back and say that the idea of Wanda doing it wasn't a red herring, I was a little bit let down, personally.
Hmm. Okay. I mean, I would say that the Infinity Stones have definitely wreaked havoc on the MCU. We've noticed that many of our superpowered beings have gotten their powers from these stones, and there's definitely no reason why they couldn't be manipulating in a more way than what we've seen. So,
like, they're pissed off at how they were used, so they're gonna screw up their lives.
Possibility.
And they're powerful enough. What's to say they don't gain sentience, you know?
Yeah, which would make sense why they're also changing the name of Sword to be Sentient.
Also, what kind of scientists? I was gonna say, what kind of scientists don't remember to turn off the microphone before you say that every other test subject has died?
Oh no, I don't think he.
I thought it wasn't on.
It wasn't on. He cuts him off and just says, "Go ahead and touch the scepter." Like he's cutting him off and just, you know, not so much cutting off the microphone. He's just telling that dude to shut the fuck up.
Yeah, the way I interpreted that, it sounded like it was just coming through the speaker.
Yeah, they definitely didn't do it clearly, but yeah. Do you think that someone planted that deed in her car, or did she just already open it and then decide she's going to go to Sword to find the body?
Naima feels that someone put it there.
I don't think it either, but it is a very weird reaction, I felt like, when she looks at it for the first time in the seat of the car.
Mm-hmm. I agree.
Okay. So you think the deed being planted there could have been part of a bigger plan to get her to do all this?
Yeah, like, if you go into what the mid-credit scene, the end-credit scene of all-white Vision, Hayward definitely needed Wanda to create something so that he would have the Wanda power source to then repower Vision. So as we come to find out, when at Sword, the video that we saw of her stealing the Vision body is something that's completely faked. She went to go see the body. She saw it. She realized that Vision wasn't there anymore, no longer part of that, and then left, like, peacefully, so to speak. The video we saw was her stealing the body. This also makes me wonder, what was it that Darcy and Wu were tracking inside the hex if it's not the real body of Vision?
It can still give off Vision's same power signature. Yeah, it
sounded like they were tracking the vibranium like decay levels or something, which means that he's physical.
Mm. Yeah, but how did she get it, though? Because she didn't have his body.
Yeah,
she made vibranium out of nothing?
I don't see why not.
I think that's what they're trying to imply.
Well, yeah, I don't know how they could imply it when they've already implied that she takes what is currently there and adapts it to look however she wants. It's not like she's creating something from nothing. It's still like the outfit that when Monica
was Geraldine
was wearing. Yeah.
Yep.
It's still Kevlar. Yeah. It's not like Kevlar cotton.
We see the creation of Vision, though. We literally saw that on camera.
Was it
for this one?
Is it a physical body of Vision, or is it just an illusion of Vision, or is it just Vision's Mind Stone self?
No sé.
I think that you're very good questions, and this is what I thought too. Like,
I have one episode, and I'm gonna be very pissed. Maybe I already.
There is a possibility that there is trace amounts of vibranium in the ground at Westview, and she pulled that out. Like, I don't know.
Yeah. Well, except based on Agatha's statement, she can create material from nothing. That's what she said. You can create something from nothing. So to me, that says it is real. It's not just an illusion. Like, if you can create, that means it has to be tangible.
So it's definitely, because she does show her examples of transmutation where she turns the fly into a bird. So there's that's more of,
but that's
like
not necessarily something from nothing. It's manipulating matter.
Right. Mm-hmm. That's what I was going to say. That's what she did to Geraldine's clothes. However, she is also able to create something from nothing, like the house.
Yeah, no, that's fair. Yeah, just because a person can draw or paint a masterpiece doesn't mean they don't get down with some stick figures from time to time.
That is true.
Like,
so yeah, she could definitely be able to do both things. Not one isn't exclusive to the other.
I have also taken to calling this white vision, this like vibranium golem. I call him Vizarro. Like
Vizarro.
Yeah.
I think there's a times where he's called anti-vision too. Not in the show, obviously, like, but in the comic books.
I liked your theory of Wanda merging the two.
So yeah, like, what do you think?
They're gonna red and blue Superman him?
Yeah, kind of like the idea that in Red and Blue Superman they split the Superman into two, and then eventually they had to put him back together. If her powers are from the Mind Stone, she created a vision with her Mind Stone, in souped up powers. If they were to merge the two, we get Vision back at the end of the series. Mm-hmm. However, like, that is the happy Disney ending. Is that going to be the ending that Marvel Studios ending is going to give us? Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Do we get a Disney ending or a Touchstone ending?
I don't like where this is going.
We're going to see Vision die like a third, maybe even a fourth time. And that's going to finally push Wanda over the edge. She's going to break the universe.
I mean, this is also a possibility.
I don't know how they get this done in an hour. This is baloney. Yeah.
It's going to be a 3-hour episode. There you go.
That might be able to do. That
sounds great.
Well, we better plan accordingly.
No, you better be up at midnight ready to watch it, because otherwise you're just going to start getting bombarded with spoilers as soon as they happen.
I don't know why happening to you, because I look up WandaVision stuff during the week and I still am not getting spoiled by Google. So
I got spoiled. The freaking spoiler that I got, it was 4 a.m. I woke up because there was a loud sound the night of when the episode came out. A full article had been put out by someone. And like, why? Why?
You know what it is? You're now part of the meme of it was Agatha all the time. Apparently. All along. That's what it is.
I don't know. I've managed to avoid spoilers, so I don't know.
I mean, I jumped on my Twitter on Friday, but I managed to avoid it too. I think one thing I did see, and I didn't, I guess I was a little bit upset, because it was a dude like in white clown makeup, and they said, "This is Vision now." And I was like,
"Oh, fuck.
Did they turn him into a clown? I don't understand." So I kind of got spoiled, but not really.
He's part of that circus.
Was it Pietro Crespi? Is that who they used for it? With like the black dots on the hat?
No, it wasn't that one.
Okay.
No, it was just a random guy.
Puddles.
Oh, Puddles Pity Party?
Yeah.
So with Hayward using his strategic mind to get a piece of Wanda imbued equipment to then power up Vision, I mean, how, I don't know how he got it put together so quickly after what he had them doing to that body at the end. Because, I mean, this has still only been a week since she went to the sword to pick up, to try and get the body in the first place, right?
Mm-hmm. Well, I half wonder if what she saw and the reason she couldn't feel Vision is because what was there wasn't really Vision.
Oh,
absolutely. That was my thought as well.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now, did anybody else? I already know the answer to this. I don't even know why I'm asking. I was like, did anybody else find it weird that they strategically chose not to include in all the anatomy that they had there there was no pelvic region, so to speak, to see if Vision was anatomically correct.
You know what? I didn't even look, John.
Yeah, same.
I paused and zoomed in. It was hard to be seen.
I did not have this thought. You were right. I think you were thinking no one else thought this. And I think you were right. You were right on the money with that one, John.
Speaking of pausing and checking out, did anybody happen to pause on the marquee of the movie theater after she changed Westview?
Yes.
Okay. What did it say? What was the movie playing?
Okay. So prior it said
Incredibles.
Tannhauser Gate. No, it wasn't those movies. It was a Tannhauser Gate and something else, and then it changed to like Red Scare and The Kidnapping.
Ooh,
interesting.
I believe.
Okay, cool. That was I was going to say. Oh, Westview. Do you think Westview was that run down when Vision originally bought the plot, or do you think that's all because of the blip and people being gone for 5 years?
The second one.
Yeah.
So that's a thing that I also found very interesting. Like, we have yet to get, even in Spider-Man Far From Home, like, we haven't really got, like, how people have had to adapt economically to being gone for 5 years.
The biggest change seems to be that anyone who was involved in landscaping died. That's all I know from this.
Well, the entire landscaping community gone.
Yeah.
Eviscerated.
Thanos really hated landscapers because they always go and mow the lawn Saturday morning when you're trying to sleep in, and that's the thing.
He's like
that should have been balanced out because half the grass would have died too.
Exactly.
I mean, I think he just said living creatures, not living organisms.
Mm-hmm.
So. Wait a minute. So there's even less bees too. Like that's kind of messed up. Like he could have
less bees, less like, birds,
endangered animals, not half the endangered animals or something.
Yeah,
he doesn't make decisions. He just does.
Snaps.
He just snaps.
Mm-hmm.
That's right.
The Great Barrier Reef was fucked.
I do feel like a snap would affect a small town a lot more than a big city that you saw in Far From Home, though. Or
yeah,
whatever.
Some of those towns only have one doctor, and then you end up having to have the coroner also do like exams.
Yeah, and that would have changed, like economic impact small towns a lot more than big cities.
That's why in Resident Alien, Alan Tudyk's character has to do all those jobs.
That's right.
Yeah,
that's
because of the snap.
Welcome to a small town.
Is there anything else that anybody would like to go over?
Yes.
Okay, John, hit us.
Another semi-tangent here, but this episode proves my hocus-pocus theory of 5 and 8, in which anyone immediately goes up 3 points of attractiveness if they dress like a witch. So Catherine Hahn already was a nice-looking lady, but here at the we lost Beth. She has left the podcast.
She walked out again. She's flipping off with both hands now.
I like how in this podcast, both Elizabeth and I have shoved the mic away from ourselves.
Because you know it biting your tongue is not strong enough. You also have to remove the input of sound.
I'm going to say something mean if I don't shove this away.
But the witchiness, it just adds a whole nother level. I just find that really interesting. It's like, you know, Sarah Jessica Parker, she's here. Dressed like a witch, she's here. It's science.
Good night for you.
I'm trying to think of like I'm trying to think of like Zachary Quinto and just like a witch's hat, and I don't know if this works.
It works. It's there. And the ears. Keep the Spock ears too.
There's like some people that are too powerful too. Like no one's gonna put Matt Bomer in a witch hat. So I can't even, you know, like how do we know? You can't be an 11.
With the Matt Bomer. Like that was the one in my head.
What? I don't understand.
No, actually, this one I kind of get.
What I don't understand is what the purpose of this tangent is.
Oh, just
The laughs.
To derail it even further.
This seems like more of an imagine-if situation.
Oh. Yeah. And to switch it to a more serious subject, I actually did absolutely love the talk between Vision and Wanda about grief.
I wanted to bring that up. That was a particularly good piece of writing. That was dialogue. That was really good. Grief is love persevering.
Yes. And all the grief I felt in that line too. So thank you. I didn't need that from an MCU show, but I got it.
But you got
but
it.
Here we are.
Here I am with one episode left and so many questions.
What else, John?
I was just going to say that this was a roller coaster of an episode because I started out really excited. I got a really bad case of the sads throughout all of those memories. Mm-hmm. And then I got really excited again by the mid-credits. So I was like, wow, like this one was a journey.
We also see why at the beginning of this series, or close to the beginning of the series, that Hayward made it a very big point to say there has been no code name for Wanda to this point. Because Captain Hahn, or Agatha, has now named her the Scarlet Witch because she is the nexus point for chaos magic, maybe. Like, this is the reason why she is able to create such elaborate things and put it on autopilot when someone like Agatha, who's been practicing for over a century, can't do nearly as much. And we got the Scarlet Witch. That's interesting.
For all the credits.
I also want to know is, like, if they did that when they were doing the experiment on Wanda with the scepter, like, that's what happened to her, and they were like, okay, let's bring in her brother now, see what happens. Like, how did that work?
Well, and what was his experience?
Yeah, what was his experience?
We're never gonna know because he actually is dead.
That's right. I mean, unless Aaron Taylor Johnson just happens to show up in the next episode. Oh, which, speaking of, had anybody seen the quote from Paul Bettany about the big surprise cameo? Like, if it's trolling here at this point, where he's like, I get in the eighth episode, I get to work with someone that I've never worked with before, or not the eighth episode, but the ninth episode, the season finale.
Someone he's always wanted to work with.
So essentially, it's going to be him versus himself, him acting against himself.
Okay.
Unless it's still going to be another character that we don't know about showing up.
Well, that was well played. That's like, I can't even be mad at that if that's what it is.
does everybody still think that we're going to see Doctor Strange at the end of the season?
Yes.
Doctor Strange is on his way?
I think
there's too much magic going on.
Okay. What'd you say, John?
No, I agree with the thing that John's saying here.
And credit, kind of. Can we just stop?
Because, John, you said the beginning of your sentence was, there's too much magic. I agree.
Yeah.
Well, he definitely would have, like, his job would be to take care of this, right? Like, wouldn't it be his job? But another thing is, I saw on TikTok somebody, and I can't remember who, because I just stroll through TikTok like no other, but somebody pointed out that the book that we saw in episode 7 potentially is a missing book from the library in the Doctor Strange movie. Like, it looks exactly like those kinds of books.
Right. It's just a copy of the Thornbirds. It's just really fantastic.
Yeah. So I feel like he would, like, but then it's also one of those moments where you're watching another MCU movie and you're like, why isn't Thor here taking care of this? Like, he could take care of it in 5 seconds. So I don't know if that's how it is. But yeah, but you're still like, okay, can Spider-Man not just like call up somebody to be like, hey, can I get some help in Europe here? I'm fighting elements. Like, no? Oh, okay.
That's fair.
Yeah.
Okay. I think we covered it all, unless anybody else wants to have something to say. If you want to
nothing
get a hold
that's
of me,
actually useful.
If you want to get a hold of me and talk about WandaVision or Knock Knock for whatever reason, find me on Twitter. I am at Mitchipedia GEM. GEM stands for Geek Elite Media. Steven, where can people find you online?
You can find me all across the internet as some version of Peppermint Gentleman, sometimes Peppermint Gent. Come and talk to me about comics that came out this week. There's a good one called Stray Dogs. That's a weird one that I'd love to hear your thoughts on.
Jessica?
Come tell me about your favorite X-Men series that I should watch next. Tweet at me as at JM Bailey Writes.
John?
You can tweet at me at Magic Bollocks. Tell me who you would like to see dressed up as a witch.
And Elizabeth.
And if you want to reach me or any of these people, you can find us at Geek Elite Media and our Facebook page / Geek Elite Media.
Please check out our website, geekelitemedia.com, for archived episodes of this podcast and other podcasts on our network. Go to patreon.com/ Geek Elite Media for being one of our patrons. You get exclusive material that only you have access to. And whatever podcatcher you use to listen to us, please rate and review us because it helps spread the word of our network.
Mm-hmm.
But until next time, this is the Geeks Watch on the Geek Elite Media Network saying always remember to
geek out.
This concludes our broadcast.